seems to me as though we've got some possibility for singing. All the people said, thank you. You did get it. Thank you. I appreciate it. Here we go. Nice. You are not alone if you are lonely when you feel afraid. You're not the only. We are all the same in need of mercy to be forgiven and be free. It's all you got to lean on, but thank God it's all you need. And all the people said amen. Whoa, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. If you're rich or poor, well, it doesn't matter. Weak or strong, you know love is what we're after. We're all broken, but we're all in this together. God knows we stumble and fall. And he so loved the world, he sent his son to save us all. And all the people said amen. Oh, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord for his love never. And all the people said amen. Blessed are the poor in spirit who are torn apart. Blessed are the persecuted for the pure in heart. Blessed are the people hungry for another start. For theirs is the kingdom of God. Said amen. Whoa, and all the people said amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for his love never ends. And all the people said amen. Thank you. A house united. There are many gifts, but the same Spirit. There are many hands, but the same Lord. There are many works, the same God who empowers them all. There are many gifts, but the same Spirit. Many hands, same Lord. There are many works, same God who empowers them all. We won't be divided. We won't be divided. We are a house. Parts, but the same body. We are many parts, but the same body. We have many songs, but one voice. We have many hearts, the same love, uniting them all. We won't be divided. We won't be. House united. We won't be divided. We church will be my church. Your children are my brothers and my sisters. Your people are my people. Your people are my people. Your church will be my church. Your children are my brothers and my sisters. We won't be divided. We are a house. We won't be divided. We are a house.
Good morning, everyone. How are you doing today?
Good.
Feeling good? Ready for worship? A little bit excited? Yeah. Okay, we'll get there. We'll get there. We'll get into it. I do want to remind you, we are going to have communion at the beginning of our service this morning. There are little kits for communion that have the wafer and the juice in the back there. So if you didn't get one, you can raise your hand. Scott has some. He can bring them up to you right down here in the front, Scott. Anybody else? You got some? All right. And before we get to communion, we're going to continue our worship with our confession and forgiveness. So I'm going to invite you to stand as you are able and let us confess our sins together. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who shines in glory, who clothes us in compassion, and bears gifts of mercy for all.
Amen. Amen. Let us confess our sins with confidence in God's promise of forgiveness. God, wonderful counselor, we confess that we have turned from your gifts and chosen our own way. We have not made room for you in our hearts or in our world. We have lived in fear. We have not welcomed the stranger. We desire gifts that will not endure. Forgive us our sins, known and unknown, and open us to receive the peace of Jesus dwelling in and among us.
Amen.
Amen.
God's loving kindness has appeared to us in Christ our Savior. We are saved not by anything we have done, but by God's mercy poured out on us richly. In the name of Jesus Christ, your sins are forgiven. Through the Spirit living in you, God give you faith to trust Jesus, who is love born for you now and always. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. The Lord be with you. We're going to see if you remember this part here. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and salutary to give God thanks and praise. It is our duty and our joy to do so in all places and in all times. We give you thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, through our Savior, Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And we remember in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." And I invite you now to take the wafer that is on the top of your communion kit. This is the body of Christ given for you. Amen. And again, after supper, Jesus took the cup. He gave thanks, and he gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. This is the blood of Christ shed for you." Amen. Together, let us pray as Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. May the body and blood of Jesus Christ keep you in God's grace and strengthen you into life everlasting. Amen. Everywhere I go, everywhere I go,
everywhere I go,
everywhere I go,
I'm gonna let it shine,
gonna let it shine,
everywhere I go,
everywhere I go,
I'm gonna let it shine,
gonna let it shine,
everywhere I go,
everywhere
I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
Beautiful, beautiful. Please join me in front here. Young ones, anybody else out there that can come forward today? Come on up here. You can bring a friend with you if you like. It's all right. Come on down. You can have a seat right up here. I love it. I love it. We're matching outfits today. I'm actually matching outfits with my friends up here as well. The robes on, we're matching all together. Today we're talking about something a little strange. Maybe you've heard it before. There's this word that comes up again and again in church and in the Bible. It's the word sin. Oh man, not cool, huh? Not cool at all. Sin, sin, sin. Do you guys know what sin even is? You do? All right, all right.
It's disrespecting one of the Ten Commandments.
Okay, disrespecting the Ten Commandments, like God's rules for us, not doing the rules?
Basically, like doing something wrong.
Doing something wrong that we shouldn't do? That kind of sums it up, huh? That sums it all up together. Well, the word sin, it comes from the Bible, a totally different language. The language is ancient Greek. So a long time ago, they spoke this language, ancient Greek. And the word in ancient Greek is hamartia. Can you say that with me?
Hamartia.
Hamartia. Very good, very good. Hamartia. And this word actually comes from the world of archery. Archery. So, you know, like you have a bow and arrow, and you take that back and you shoot your bow and arrow, you shoot the arrow, and what happens? Sometimes you hit the target, right? The circle where you're trying to aim at, but and it just goes off and you shoot somebody else on accident or something like that. You miss the mark. It just goes in the wrong direction. That's what the word hamartia means. It means to miss the mark. Like when you're shooting a bow and arrow, missing the mark. So I actually want you guys to help me out with something. I have something up here. I'm going to grab it real quick, just a sec. Watch out there. We got a bow and arrow up here, people. Although very soft, not dangerous. So, not dangerous. So, who would like to try this out? You want to try it out? All right, come up here with me. We're going to do it away from the people and away from anything that can break. So, over here we have this castle. We have this castle. Oh, and we have two of our friends who are hanging out on top of the castle. This is the camel who went through the eye of the needle. Say hi to the camel who went through the eye of the needle. And this is our friend, the puffin.
Hello, puffin.
Hello, puffin. All right, so you're going to aim. You can aim at either one you want. Let's see, how far away should he be? About right here, you think? Not that far. We don't want you to miss that badly. I mean, we don't want to show how great you are at shooting this bow and arrow. All right. So this is how it works. You gotta hold it right here, okay? You hold it, you attach it here. Don't pull it back too far. Just a little ways is plenty, okay? All right, I'm gonna give it to you. Grab that end right there. All right, let's see if you can hit one of our friends. Oh, so sad. Oh, that was a close one. That was a good try. Give him a round of applause. Good try. Very good. Anybody else wanna give it a try? You want to try? All right, come on up here. So you got to hold it like this with one hand. And then you're going to hold on to the end right here. Just this part. See that? Just this part right here, that black part. And then you're going to clip it in here. Let me help you out a little bit. All right, anybody else want to give it a try? You win already. Zelda, no? Anybody? Okay, that's fine, that's fine. We don't have to keep going. That was really close. Okay, so that's basically where that word comes from. You're aiming at something and you miss it. You just go a little bit wide. That's what it means to sin. Or when we don't do what we're supposed to do, we're aiming for something. What do you think we're aiming for? Puffin, but what do the puffins, our friends, represent? Okay, like good deeds. Yeah, exactly. Doing good things for others. We have these things that are values for us, like love. We're trying to love other people. We're trying to do what's good, tell the truth, no lying, and all of these things. Maybe have courage. Trying to have courage in the world to do what's right. We have faith and hope, all of these things, but we're bound throughout our lives, at some point at least, to miss the mark. We're aiming for doing these good things, but it misses the mark and we can't quite get it. So, what do we do when we're practicing archery and we miss the mark? What happens after that? If you're practicing and you miss, what do you do then? You failed, but then where do you go from there? Where do you go after you miss the mark? You try again. Exactly. Is that what you were going to say? Yeah, you try again. You fail, and you try again. And there's even something you can do when you make a mistake or you fail. You learn. Yes, we learn from when we don't follow exactly what we want to do and we don't hit what we're aiming for. We learn and we try again and get it better the next time until we can hit that mark with that bow and arrow. It takes a lot of practice, right? With a real bow and arrow. I mean, you got to work at it and work at it to get really, really good. And that's what we do when we're aiming toward what God wants for us as well. We try and we try and we try again to love others throughout our lives. All right, that is our message. Does anybody want to try one more time? See if you can do it. You want to try again? All right, give it a go. Come on, you got this. Oh, that was closer though. That was closer. See, he's getting closer to the mark. And that's what we do in our lives as well. We try and try to get closer to that mark. All right, you guys, thank you so much for coming up here. Have a wonderful time at Sunday school. And let's all stand to our feet and sing together to our God.
Let us pray. Most holy God, the earth is filled with your glory, and before you, angels and saints, stand in awe. Enlarge our vision to see your power at work in the world, and by your grace, make us heralds of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. You may be seated.
The first reading is from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, beginning at the first verse. Now I would remind you, brothers and sisters, of the good news that I proclaimed to you, which you in turn received, in which also you stand, through which also you are being saved, if you hold firmly to the message that I proclaimed to you, unless you have come to believe in vain. For I handed on to you as of first importance what I in turn had received, that Christ died for our sins in accordance with the scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day in accordance with the scriptures, and that he appeared to Cephas, then to the 12, then he appeared to more than 500 brothers and sisters at one time, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all the apostles. Last of all, as to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. For I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle, because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me has not been in vain. On the contrary, I worked harder than any of them, though it was not I, but the grace of God that is with me. Whether then it was I or they, so we proclaim, excuse me, and so you have come to believe. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. Psalm 138, we read this responsively. I will give thanks to you, O Lord, with my whole heart. Before the gods, I will sing your praise. I will bow down toward your holy temple and praise your name because of your steadfast love and faithfulness. For you have been glorified your name and your word above all things. When I called, you answered me. You increased my strength within me. All the rulers of the earth will praise you, O Lord, when they have heard the words of your mouth. They will sing of the ways of the Lord, that great is the glory of the Lord. The Lord is high, yet cares for the lowly, perceiving the haughty from afar. Though I walk in the midst of trouble, you keep me safe. You stretch forth your hand against the fury of my enemies. Your right hand shall save me. You will make good your purpose for me, O Lord. Your steadfast love endures forever. Do not abandon the works of your hands. Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
Open your ears, O faithful people. Open your ears and hear God's word. Open your hearts, O royal priesthood. God has come to you. Torah, ora, Torah, ora, alleluia. Torah, ora, Torah, ora, alleluia. Torah, ora, Torah, ora, alleluia. Torah, ora, Torah, ora, alleluia.
They who have ears to hear the message.
They who have ears to hear the message.
They who have ears,
now let them hear.
They who would learn the way of wisdom,
let them hear God's word.
God has spoken.
God has spoken to the people. Alleluia.
God has spoken words of wisdom. Alleluia.
God has spoken.
God has spoken to the people. Alleluia.
God has spoken words of wisdom. Alleluia.
actually going to need some help with this gospel reading. Would anybody like to be the narrator? You can come forward right now. Come on down. Who's with me? All right, and we need somebody to be Jesus. Who wants to be Jesus this morning? Come on down, people. Anybody? Nobody wants to be Jesus. Come on now, don't leave me hanging up here. Somebody's got to be Jesus, or I'll be like that teacher who just calls on people. George, get on down here. Get on down here and be Jesus. Come on. I saw you over there with your orangey. You shouldn't have worn a shirt that was so bright. It was too good. Oh, and we need Simon Peter. Come on now. Who wants to be Simon Peter? Anybody? Anybody? How about Andy? I see Andy over there. Come on over. So,
okay.
Oh, you got the words right there. Lovely, lovely. I'm just going to say the opening part, and then you guys take it away.
Okay.
Take it away, all right? So today's gospel reading is from the book of Luke, beginning in the 5th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord.
Got it? Once, while Jesus was standing beside the lake of Gennesaret, and the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God, he saw two boats there at the shore of the lake. The fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to put out a little way from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the crowds from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon,
"Put out into the deep water and let down your nets for a catch."
"Master, we have worked all night long, but we have caught nothing. Yet, if you say no, I will let down the nets."
When they had done this, they caught so many fish that their nets were beginning to break. So they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them. And they came and filled both boats so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at Jesus' knees, saying,
"Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man."
For he and all who were with him were amazed at the catch of fish they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. Then Jesus said to Simon,
"Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching people."
And when they had brought their boats to shore, they left everything and followed him.
The Gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. And let's give thanks to our readers who came up. Some of their own volition and some were forced into it. But either way, we appreciate you greatly. We do indeed appreciate you. I see a connection here in these verses from the gospel, what we read from Paul, and a chapter from Isaiah in the Old Testament in chapter 6. It's a very well-known story in Isaiah, where Isaiah is having this vision of being in the throne room with God. He goes to where God dwells. He sees God sitting on the throne. And if you'll remember, there's all these angels. Some of them are sitting there. Some of them are flying around. They're very strange looking. They have 6 wings, and they're flying with some. They're covering themselves with others. And he feels completely unworthy to be in this space. And the angels are saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." And Isaiah says, "Woe is me, I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. Yet my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." And do you guys remember in this story, one of the angels grabs something and takes it to Isaiah. Does anybody remember what it was? A coal, yeah, a burning piece of coal. And what does the angel do with that coal? touches it to his lips, to his mouth, exactly. Basically, close enough. He touches it to his lips, and he says, now your guilt has departed. It has been blotted out. You are forgiven of your sin. And then he says that famous line. The Lord says, whom shall I send and who will go for us? And Isaiah says, here I am. Send me, Lord. Here I am. Send me. But there's this idea of uncleanliness that Isaiah feels in the presence of God. And we find it throughout our readings. Isaiah, Paul, Peter, they all feel the same way. Paul said, for I am the least of the apostles, unfit to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. Paul, like Isaiah, recognizes he's unfit for this role that he has been called into. He's unfit to be one of God's apostles, unfit to proclaim this gospel to the world. I think many of us can resonate with that perspective, right? Because maybe who we are, because of our past, what we may have done, we know we are not worthy. We are just not worthy to be in the presence of God or to be called into so sacred and holy a ministry as to be messengers of Jesus Christ and followers of Christ. But maybe some of us feel the opposite. Maybe we feel like we're just trying to be good people in the world. Maybe we do feel like we're worthy, in a sense, to be followers of Christ and followers of God, but I'd have to ask, maybe we're not being fully honest with ourselves and what is in our hearts. Scripture is very clear on this fact that there is an inclination in the human heart toward evil. All have fallen short. All have sinned. And I think not just Scripture, but history is very clear on this fact as well. We can just look back on the last 100 years of our world, see how many millions and millions of people were killed unnecessarily from human-made catastrophes in our world. We can see that humans often lean toward the evil in our hearts. We see Isaiah didn't just say his lips were unclean, but he was from a whole people, a whole society of people that had unclean lips. And we know there was a lot of political turmoil that was going on when Isaiah was alive. It says that the king actually had just died. There was a transition happening in the power dynamics, and we know that shortly after he lived, the northern kingdom of Israel would be invaded. Many cities would be destroyed. There was a lot of catastrophe, human-made catastrophe, and turmoil going on. And a lot of the people who were living in those places in their own hearts were not following after God's law and God's will. I don't see a whole lot of difference between that time, which was almost 3,000 years ago, and our time, our world today. I heard recently there was a coup in a country in Africa just a couple weeks ago. They had terrorists that were coming into the country. They were destabilizing things, and the military just took over and said, the government's not doing a good job. This democratically elected government is not doing a good job, and the military just took things over. And I think that's like the fifth or maybe sixth or seventh one that's happened in like the last 5 years of destabilizing countries where the military just decides to take over. And apparently the people weren't all that upset about it either, because they were having their lives destroyed by these insurgents and terrorists that were coming into their country. We see it all over the world. I hear a lot about human trafficking that goes on, young people being taken and sold basically into slavery, all kinds of evils. I got a report recently about deaths from drug addiction topped 100,000 for the first time in our country last year. 100,000 people dying from drug-related addictions, all kinds of evil in the world, and it stems from the problems of our own human hearts. And when we come from this place recognizing this evil that's a part of all of us, it really is difficult to approach God in that way. God, who is ultimately good and just and true and loving, those aims that we talked about in the children's message, what we're aiming for, but we go off the mark. It's hard to come to God in that position. The first thing we need to do is just recognize that this is actually true. A lot of times we don't want to recognize that there is evil in the world, or we can recognize the evil out there in the world, but we can't recognize the evil that is in our own hearts or accept that it is a reality. That we have definitely missed the mark in a number of ways, and that we need repentance, just like Isaiah needed that repentance, just like Paul needed to repent of his former life, and Peter did as well. That's why that burning coal is so important that touches his lips. That coal symbolizes the cleansing that repentance brings, but it also signifies that it's not always an easy process. It is burning. It is painful in a number of ways to accept that that evil is a reality, but it is necessary for us as people of God. Isaiah feared God because of his uncleanliness. But when that sin was taken away from him, when that guilt was gone, he is able to stand before God. And not just that, to become God's messenger to the people, to serve and follow after God. In the same way, Paul was completely in the wrong. He was persecuting the church of Christ, but then Christ appears to him in this blinding vision. It leaves him without his eyesight for 3 days. He goes through this process of transformation, and after that, and repentance, he's finally able to accept his calling from God to bring God's message of grace and love to the people who are considered the Gentiles. And not only that, he's able to work harder than anybody else in the church because of the grace of God in his own life. We see in this reading from the gospel that first, Jesus just asked Peter to help him. He says, let me borrow your boat. I'm going to go out here. I'm going to preach and teach from your boat because everybody's crowding in too much and they can't see me. They can't understand what I'm saying. So he gets out there. He teaches the word of God. And then right after that, he tells him, go ahead and try and fish again. And we know that Peter already respects him as a teacher. He calls him master right away. He knows he is a good teacher. He calls him master or lord, however you want to translate that. But he says, we've been out here all night. We haven't managed to catch anything. But he still follows his instructions. And what happens? They catch more than they could have possibly imagined or conceived. And through this miracle, Peter realizes that Jesus is not just a good teacher. He's not just a wise person. He's a truly holy man, a man who is set apart, and he realizes he's standing right next to him. And here he is, an unclean person, standing next to this holy man of God, and so he bows down before him and says, I am not worthy. I'm not worthy to be next to you. But Jesus says, do not be afraid. How many times do we hear this in Scripture, especially in this Gospel of Luke that we're reading from? Do not be afraid. Move away from that fear of your own unworthiness and move into something new. Jesus was there to bring transformation to his life, to change him into a new person. Someone that would be able to go out and become a catcher of people. Someone who could bring the good news, the gospel of Christ, to people who were in need. And they left everything so that they could follow after Jesus. We could be in the same boat, metaphorically speaking, as Peter and the disciples, trying to do something with our lives and failing spectacularly, having nothing to show for it at the end of the day. But if we can turn to Christ, if we can turn to God, if we can aim toward that higher good that is God in the world around us, then maybe we can do things that are amazing and miraculous like the disciples did that day. We see the scarcity of the world around us. It's an apparent reality to us, that scarcity that is in the world. But God says there is abundance just beyond your perception of things, right beyond your knowledge of the world. There are resources beyond what you could imagine with your limited imagination. With God, there is abundance where we see scarcity in the world. With God, there's so much abundance that it overflows from us. When we can trust in that fountain, it will flow out of us into the lives of those who are around us. Jesus showed them that abundance, and after that, calls them to follow him and eventually to proclaim who Jesus is, to proclaim where that abundance comes from. That is their faith in Jesus Christ. So our proper relationship to God, our relation and our standing to God is one of gratitude, as we learn in our psalm today, giving thanks to God. As Peter bowed down before Jesus, so we do the same. But we do so out of gratitude for the grace that has been shown to us, not out of that fear of being unworthy or what could happen to us. I mean, we recognize that we live in awe and reverence of who God is, because in many ways, God is so far beyond us. God is lofty and far away, like the vision that Isaiah had of God on that throne. But yet, at the same time, God is accessible to us. God is unimaginable in some ways, stern and unrelenting. Yet, God also treats us like a mother hen that gathers together its brood and leads them to safety. God protects especially those who are most vulnerable in the world, those who are most in need. And when we really think about it, we are all so vulnerable in many, many ways. If we can recognize that fact, maybe we can learn to trust in Jesus. Through Christ, we're able to access this ineffable God that is beyond our imagination and have a closer relationship to God, one based in love and grace and even friendship, appreciation, and gratitude. Yes, there is wonder at who God is, but not that negative fear that paralyzes us from moving out and transforming the world around us, just as we have been transformed by that grace. It's said in our psalm that though the Lord is high, he regards the lowly, but the haughty he perceives from far away. We're called to that humility in God's presence. But yet we say with the psalmist as well, the Lord will fulfill his purpose for me. Your steadfast love, O Lord, endures forever. We can feel that love of God with our whole heart, and we can give thanks to God from that place of love and put God in God's rightful place before anything else that would get in the way of who God is and our relationship together. And from that place, we can go out and declare who God is to the nations. We can share who God is and what we believe, but not in a legalistic or simplistic kind of way. The world is in desperate need of God's love, but many people are turned off by the ways that the church has tried to share who God is. In the past, there was a recent poll that came out that for the first time ever in our country, less than 50% of people in this country belong to a church or belong to a specific church group. Many, many people still say they believe in God, that they believe in spirituality, that they want to be spiritual people, but they've been turned away from the church for many reasons. And it's not all the church's fault. Many people, for their own issues or own problems, don't want to be a part of the church. Maybe they don't want to admit that actually they need some repentance in their lives, just like we don't want to admit that we need to have repentance in our lives as well. But I think if we can go into the world with a humble sense and focus more on sharing our experience of God, our experience of God's grace and love, not the doctrines that we learned necessarily, not the legalism that we learn, but how God has been active and at work in our hearts and in our minds, and God has worked to transform us in ways that we couldn't possibly imagine. Perhaps if we can go out with that sense of sharing from the gratitude that is in our hearts, maybe the world can actually listen. And maybe they can see that there is need for repentance. Maybe we can endure in this calling and this ministry. Even if it looks difficult right now, we can see how powerful it is and can be in the world. We have an awesome responsibility. Paul said that the story of Jesus had been passed down to him. And he was in turn passing that story down to the future generations that came after him. We have received that same story 2,000 years later. It has been given to us. And we have come to believe just like they believed 2,000 years ago. And we are called to that same mission to continue to pass down this story to those who need it so desperately. The story of repentance, forgiveness of sins, and ultimately God's grace and love. What brings us from death into new life and resurrection. We receive this story. We stand in it. We are truly being saved by this story in the present right now. And we believe this to be true. So we can follow Jesus into an unknown, uncertain future, trusting just as we proclaim God's grace and love to the world. Can I get an amen for that? Can I get a thanks be to God? Say alleluia. Amen. Please stand as you're able.
One. Our Father everlasting, the all-creating One, God Almighty. Through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit, one God in three in one. I believe in the resurrection, our way will rise again. For I believe in the name of Jesus. Our judge and our defender, served and crucified, forgiveness is in you. Descended into darkness, you rose in glorious life, forever seated high. I believe in God the Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again, for I believe in the name of Jesus. I believe in you. I believe in you. I believe you rose again. I believe that Jesus is Lord. I believe in God our Father. I believe in God our Father. I believe in Christ the Son. I believe in the Holy Spirit. Our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again. for I believe in the name of Jesus. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. Where you move, I'll move. I will follow. All your ways are good. All your ways are good. All your ways are sure. I will trust in you alone, higher than my sight, high above my life. I will trust in you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. Where you move, I'll move. I will follow you. Whom you love, I'll love. Whom you serve, I'll serve. In this life I lose, I will follow you. Yeah, I will follow you. Light into the world. Light into the world, light into my life. I will trust for you alone. You're the one I seek, knowing I will find all I need in you alone. Where you go, I'll go. Where you go, I'll go. Where you stay, I'll stay. Where you move, I'll move. I will follow you. When you love, I'll love. When you serve, I'll serve. This life I lose, I will follow you.
This is the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, the Creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried, descended into the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated on the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen.
You are welcome to be seated as we sing, Great is Thy Faithfulness.
Great is Thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with Thee. Thou changest not Thy compassions, they fail not as Thou hast been.
In manifold witness to
The offering prayer. O God, receive these gifts as you receive us, like a mother receives her child with arms open wide. Nourish us anew in your tender care and empower us in faithful service to tend to others with the same love, through Jesus Christ, our saving grace. Amen. Let us pray to God, saying, Holy God, stir our hearts with your grace. In this Black History Month, we give gratitude for the gifts of ministry that our sisters and brothers of color share with us, for the theologians, elders, musicians, missionaries, pastors, and others who have shaped us and continue to challenge us. We give thanks. Help those of us who are not persons of color to value their leadership stories in order that we might embody the unity of the body of Christ. Holy God, stir our hearts with your grace. We pray for those who struggle with addiction and for their families and friends. We ask that they may find the help they need and that they may not be shamed for their illness. Help us be a community of support for those who are drowning in substance abuse. Holy God, stir our hearts with your grace. We pray for those among us who have elderly parents with health problems. Our parents have done so much for us, and for many of us, the time has come for us to care for them. For those who feel overwhelmed by the responsibilities before them, we pray. Holy God, stir our hearts with your grace.
God, we pray that you would equip your church to proclaim the good news that we have first received, the forgiveness and grace shown to us through Jesus Christ. Send us out as apostles, sharing the hope of your salvation with a waiting world. Holy God, stir our hearts with your grace. Holy are you, O God of hosts. Heaven and earth are filled with your glory. Reveal your splendor in fiery sunsets and in deep blue twilights. Teach us to recognize you in the beauty of our natural world. Holy God, stir our hearts with your grace. Soften the hearts of rulers and governments that they perceive and tend to the needs of their people. Remove corruption and the impulse toward violence. Protect first responders and military personnel who risk their lives in service of others. Holy God,
stir our hearts with your grace.
The disciples received help from partners as they brought in an abundant catch of fish. So strengthen this congregation's partnerships with community organizations and ministries, especially Pathways of Hope, OC United, Crittenton, Madre Asunta, Alpha, and more. Multiply our shared efforts and bring joy to our relationships. Holy God,
stir our hearts with your grace.
We give thanks for our ancestors in faith who boldly answered your call. By their example, give us courage to live in faith and to proclaim your mercy until the day that you gather us into your glory. Holy God,
stir our hearts with your grace.
Your steadfast love endures forever. Do not abandon those who look to you for hope and healing. Bless doctors, nurses, social workers, therapists, and all caregivers. Draw near to those who are scared, sick, or in pain. We pray for all those who need your love and mercy, who we lift up to you now in silence. Holy God,
Stir our hearts with your grace.
Since we have such great hope in your promises, O God, we lift these and all of our prayers to you in confidence and faith. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Amen. invite you to be seated or remain seated if you're already doing so. Have a few announcements for you this morning. We do want to give thanks for the flowers that are on the altar given by Diana Bach in honor of her son David. Thank you very much for the flowers. And we are having our Bible study continue as well every Sunday from 9 to 9:45. Today we went through the story of Noah and the flood. Next week we're going to be going through the Tower of Babel story. So you can read ahead if you want to. Look in chapters 10 and 11 of Genesis and come and join us. You can also join online for those who are online currently that would like to do so. Just ask the office and we'll get you that Zoom link. For Pathways of Hope this month, we are receiving canned soup in honor of Super Bowl Sunday. So bring in your canned soup this month. And then for Operation Christmas Child, we will be receiving socks. Socks for Operation Christmas Child. So bring in those two items as you are able to help and support those ministries.
That's it.
Other announcements? Today, I believe we have our, is Sheila here? I can't see Sheila here. I think we're having evangelism meeting after worship. So if you are interested in evangelism, actually, no, I'm sorry, it's next Sunday. Next Sunday, I got that messed up. Thank you, Pearl, yes. Next Sunday, so please come and join us for that evangelism mission as we talk about how we can continue to reach out to our community and share our experiences of God's grace and love, and how we can reach out to our fellow members of this community as well to continue to be a part of the body of Christ here at St. Paul Lutheran Church. We don't have a lot of announcements, but there's a lot going to be coming up soon. So Lent is just around the corner and the beginning of March. Kicks off with Ash Wednesday, of course, and then we go through that. So it's going to be a very busy time of year. We're having a lull in between the busy season, which is kind of nice. It was maybe a good thing to have a little bit of that lull going on. But be on the lookout for a lot of stuff coming up in March and beyond. Oh, and one last thing. We still don't know the date for Donna Austin's memorial service, so we will find that out on the 14th. Of this month. We should know when that will be, and we'll let you all know as soon as we can about that. Okay, I believe those are all of our announcements. I'll invite you to stand as you are able, and let us receive this blessing. God, who leads you in pathways of righteousness, who rejoices over you, and who calls you by name, bless your going out and your coming in today and forever. Amen.
If you would like to come forward during this next Make a Difference, you're welcome to do the offering. And if you...
Oh, we didn't get to... didn't do it during the song.
My fault. And if you want a bus to move while you're coming up, that's great.
Please
with me.
Do. I want to see. Yeah. I want to see.
You give your life to make a difference. You gave your life to make a change. You welcomed all to your table. You're calling me to do the same. I want my life to make a difference. I want my life to make a change. I want my, thank you, to make some good here. I want my life to make some change. Working side by side. Working side by side. No out or inside. Together we can make that change. With a few or many. With a lot or not any. Together we can make that change. I want my life to make a difference. I want my life to make a change. I want my life to do some good here. day. Crossing the great divide, crossing the great divide, joy and peace will abide. Together we can make that change. Jesus is our peace, all fighting will cease. Together we can make that change. I want my life to make a difference. I want my life to make a change. I want my life to do some good here. I want my life to make a change.
Let's go make a difference. We are the citizens with the saints, with the sins. This is end division, big kill. Past hostility is history. One body bringing unity, new humanity. Family's reality, we used to be distant. But now we all together and we're making a difference. Walk alongside you, I don't want to fight you. Christ is our peace, our prophet like Elijah. Savior that'll save you, we're no longer strangers. We have been afraid, but now we are neighbors. Walls fall like, oh, hey, and the cornerstone's Christ. Our peace and the prophet of life. Hold us together and guide us tonight. Show us how you want us to serve, how you want us to listen. With you, we'll be making a difference.
I want my life to make a difference. I want my life to make a change. I want my life to do some good here. I want my life to make it. We're the citizens, we're the saints. We're the citizens, we're the saints. We're the sunshine and the rain. We're the joy and the pain. We're the change. You healed the sick and fed the poor. Love the prophet and the whore. Through us you will do more. We're the change. I want my life to make a difference. I want my life to make a change. I want my life to do some good here. I want my life to make some change.
Go with Christ into a weary world. Share the good news.
Thanks be to God. To make a difference, I want my life to make a change. I want my life to do some good here. I want my